Welcome back to this teaching on the Tabernacle of Moses. We're about to enter into the Holy of Holies. There are three things that God gives His redeemed church, and we've talked at length about two of them. One is, in the Ark of the Covenant, there was bread, the manna, the heavenly food. That's Jesus. We've talked about Jesus. Another thing is Aaron's rod that budded. This was a rod that was dead, and it came to life. This is resurrection power. This is the Holy Spirit power. We talked about that in the holy place. But the third thing that was in the Ark of the Covenant, and which I find the most exciting, was the tablets of the law. These are the Ten Commandments. These are very, very important. This is God's legal authority. Not only has He given us His Son and His Spirit, He has given us His legal authority on earth, if we learn how to use it. And that's what I want to tell you how to do. Inside the Ark of the Covenant, there's two pieces of furniture here. There's an ark down below, which is a big box, which is like a giant semiconductor. It probably transmitted all kinds of electricity. This top part with two cherubim on it, that was the mercy seat. So that's how you get seven pieces of furniture. This one's two. We'll talk about the mercy seat last. But in the Ark of the Covenant, these Ten Commandments, notice you've got 10 fingers on your hands, 10 digits. I think God knew that you were going to need them because there's 10 ruler spirits. There's three that counterfeit the Trinity. They're identified in the book of Revelation, the dragon, the false prophet, and the beast. These three counterfeit God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They are your enemies, and they are identified in the first three commandments. In the Bible, it says that God doesn't want us to take the names of foreign gods on our lips. That's why their names are not that clear in the scriptures. If you go through, like I did, I spent several years going through the Bible on this, and there are about 20 evil spirits mentioned, and there's about 10 in the Old Testament and 10 in the New Testament. And you start studying them, you think, well, they're the same dudes with different names. And all through the Old Testament, they've got different names. And that's because God doesn't want you getting familiar. He doesn't want you on a first-name basis with an evil spirit. So in the Ten Commandments, He tells you what their function is, and that is enough. Because all you've got to do is bind these 10 ruler spirits, and that takes care of all the little ones. The last seven commandments address the counterfeit of the Holy Spirit. Now, when I told you this was a three-compartment structure, I should have mentioned that in the Old Testament, the revelation of God, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is God. I'm the God of Abraham, the God of Jacob, or of Isaac, and of Jacob. Jacob had a twin, and he had an evil twin named Esau, whom God says twice, Jacob I've loved, but Esau I have hated. All right, this evil twin of the Holy Spirit is the unholy spirit. That's where you get those seven abominations that we talked about earlier. In the last seven commandments, the last five are easy. Most anybody would recognize, yeah, there's probably a spirit of murder out there and a spirit of adultery. And yeah, we know there's a thief and there's lying spirits and there's greed. But the first five aren't that easy to identify. But if you memorize the Ten Commandments, you'll have at your fingertips, if you've got the Jesus in your heart, the manna, and you've got the power of the Holy Spirit, resurrection power, then all you've got to do is apply these Ten Commandments and you're going to set your household free. You're going to set your community free. You're going to set yourself free because this is God's power of attorney. When Abraham went into the land, he was told that there were 10 strongholds there. This is in Genesis 15, 19 through 21. There was the Kenite, the Kenizzite, the Kadmonite, the Hittite. You're going to recognize these. The Perizzite, the Rephaim, the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Girgashite, and the Jebusite. And Abraham had these 10 strongholds facing him. And, of course, all those names mean something in the Hebrew. Later on, when they go into Canaan, there's seven nations that have these strongholds. And God tells them to wipe them out, utterly destroy them, which they didn't do, unfortunately. In the first commandment, you remember it says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of bondage. There is a spirit of bondage. This is the dragon. There is one place on earth where the dragon is still worshipped to some extent. They have festivals for him. And this is the land of bondage. This is in the Far East. These people have an oppressor. They have tyranny to live with. When we start binding the dragon, we start binding the oppressor, whatever you want to call him, we're going to pull down that oppression in that area. The next one, he says, I'm a possessive God. Don't make graven images. Don't have little amulets and things that you treasure and you hang around your house and you worship and you look at and you think about. Don't have little beads around your neck that you pray to, because all of those things can be houses and habitats for demon spirits. There is a spirit of Python or divination that comes upon people that have collected these objects. That's why in the book of Acts, when the people that were into witchcraft got saved, they burned their books. They got rid of the objects of worship. God says, don't have these things around. You're going to bring that spirit into your household. That's the false prophet, incidentally. The beast, third commandment, it talks about not taking his name in vain or blaspheming. This spirit is prevalent in the Middle East. This is a spirit of blasphemy, you could call it, or vanity, pride, arrogance. This is in the New Testament as well. The fourth commandment commands you to rest. It also commands you to work 6 days. And it probably was meant for that you fasted on the seventh day, because that was the only day that there wasn't any manna. There is a spirit that would cause you to not be able to rest. There is a destroying spirit. The next commandment was honor your parents, that you may live a long time. There is a spirit that would cause you to not want to honor your parents, and this is the accuser, accusing spirits. Then I've mentioned the last five commandments. There is a spirit of death. Incidentally, that coincides with the Rephaim. That means death. The Amorite means to boast. There's a spirit of an adultery. In fact, there's a spirit of adultery on this land. That was one of the problems Ephraim had. It's called in the scripture the loose woman, the harlot. You don't want to come under her dominion. There is a thief. If you will just, this one spirit, if you bind the thief off of your household, you'll see financial blessing come in. Just say, you know, I bind the thief. You'll not steal the blessings that God has provided for this household, not the spiritual, the financial, the emotional blessings, not the call of God on the lives of my children. You bind that thief. This is power. This is God's power. The liar, the deceiver. You bind the deceiver from deceiving your household. You bind lying spirits from coming between you and your spouse, because the lying spirits are telling him all kinds of things about you, and they're telling you all kinds of things about him. Bind the lying spirits and set your marriage free. Last, it says, do not covet. There is a spirit of greed. You don't want to get involved in gambling, not even on a small scale, because there is a tendency to lust after things. So with these 10 spirits bound, you're going to see victory. To give you a little more background on those first three, in the Old Testament, because we will encounter them in the last times, the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet, they all possessed someone in the Old Testament. You probably heard sermons on Satan, and they'll take you to Isaiah 14, and they'll talk about Lucifer and the day star and falling from heaven. But if you go back and read that in context, it's talking to King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. So apparently something possessed him. Okay, the other sermons you're going to hear on Satan will be out of Ezekiel. And in Ezekiel, there is one where it talks about every precious stone was your covering. You're talking about the false prophet who possessed Eshbaal, the king of Tyre, who was Jezebel's father. Another place where you might hear something preached about Satan was in the king of Egypt, Pharaoh Necho, in fact, who started the Suez Canal 1,000 years ago. In Ezekiel 29 through 31, he's talking to Pharaoh Necho, and all of a sudden he starts prophesying and says, you are the dragon that lives in the seas. And he's no longer talking about a man. So these three were present in Old Testament times, inhabiting rulers. And they probably will come forth again in our generation, inhabiting rulers of people. There's also three names for dinosaur-like beasts in the Old Testament. At the end of the book of Job, it talks about Behemoth, talks about Leviathan. And then there's one more mentioned in various places called Rahab. And this is not the same Rahab the harlot. This is a different Rahab. And if you want to study those three, they probably relate to this unholy trinity. But just as Christ has a bride for whom he died, the beast has a harlot whom he kills. And you'll need to read the book of Revelation for that. Okay, enough said about the power of attorney inside this box. Those three things, the manna, the Aaron's rod that budded, and the Ten Commandments. That's all the power you need. If you have those three residing within you, you're in here. And now comes the rest. Notice these two kind of like angels. The cherubim represented the two covenants. You have an Old Testament and a New Testament. There's really only two covenants. The Abrahamic covenant was extended to his seed and it was renewed, but it was the covenant of peace. There was a covenant given to grace, of grace to Noah. And those are the two covenants, grace and peace. Those are the two cherubim, and they have guardians. The guardian of the covenant of peace is Jesus. He says, he is our peace. The guardian of the covenant of grace is the Holy Spirit. And the sign of the rainbow was given to Noah because the Holy Spirit is sevenfold. I think Paul recognized this because in every letter, every epistle he wrote, at the very beginning, he would say, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he would end every letter with, grace be unto you. Since only the high priest got to go this far, God had to represent those two in other ways to the Israelites. There were two pillars on the temple when they built the temple. Joachim and Boaz, they had two pillars. They represented Jesus and the Holy Spirit. They had two silver trumpets. When they'd call the people for war, or they'd call them to come together for an assembly, they'd blow these two silver trumpets, and they represented the Holy Spirit and Jesus. As a matter of fact, when they wanted to call the people together, they would blow the two trumpets together at the same time, just like when Paul would say, grace and peace, at the beginning of his letters. And when they convened the people, they would just blow at once, just like Paul did when he'd say, grace be unto you. So a lot of these things were revealed to the apostles because they were students of the Jewish scriptures. One more thing I'd like to mention is at the end of the book of Job, God tells, let me read it to you, Job 40, verse 6, and then skipping around all the way to verse 14, I've abbreviated this. Then answered the Lord unto Job out of the whirlwind and said, deck thyself now, array thyself. Remember we talked about the garments. Look on everyone that is proud and bring him low. I was just talking about that, binding the spirit of pride. Tread down the wicked in their place. Hide them in the dust. Bind their faces in secret. And then, and this is the last thing God says before he starts talking about Behemoth and Leviathan. He says, then I will confess to you that your own right hand can save you. In other words, God was waiting for Job to realize the power that he had. And he finally did realize that power, and I'm hoping that you realize the power that you have. One word of warning is when this ark was carried, in Chronicles it tells us how it was carried properly. It was carried by 8 priests. It gives their names. And they had these staves on their shoulders, and there would be 4 on either side of the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat, and they walked in unison. Now, when they put it on an ox cart one time, a man died. And that was because they were all milling around the ox cart. And David didn't understand this. He thought, Lord, we're, you know, our heart's right. We're just trying to get it to the next place. I mean, the guy was just trying to steady it. And God said, look it up, you know. So he went back to the scriptures and he found out the priests had to carry it on their shoulders. So David thought, well, you know, we'll try it. So he gets these priests together and they heave the thing up on their shoulders. It took them about 6 steps for David to figure out what was going on. And that's because this is not something that God tells you. This is something he shows you. If you're not walking in unity, about 8 people walking in unity, then you can't carry the testimony of God effectively. In fact, it's very dangerous to carry the testimony of God all by yourself, milling around doing your own thing. There has to be a quorum of people who are in unity. They're approximately the same stature, and they're walking in unison. And that was what God showed David. And David got so excited, he started dancing because he saw it. He really saw unity, and he saw that's how you carry God's testimony.